growth of project management in India and the working together of the seven Indian chapters to put this on. Matter of fact, I'd like to just take a moment and maybe you can join me to acknowledge Mr. VSR and the leadership for organizing this conference and the over 100 volunteers that have helped put this together. I'd also like to, as well as preparing for this event, and acknowledge the work of, as Mr. VSR mentioned, around Team India and the current presidents of the seven Indian chapters in working together to have the coordinated event of such a wonderful event here with over 700 people attending. It is truly a remarkable growth that we've seen over the last few years here in India. So congratulations to the seven chapter leaders in India as well. So for today, though, I'm here to talk about project management as a strategic competency and how project management has evolved from often a tactical skill set into one that's being used by organizations to transform them. And in fact, here in India, it's used to be Transform India, and we've seen some of that already in the earlier remarks. Well, here's just some examples of organizations here in India that are using project management to transform the way they do business and to help your country transform itself. Now, it's not a measure of whether these organizations are recognized as a leader in their market or very large, whether you measure that by number of employees, profit, or revenue, but it's a recognition of how these organizations are using project management and how they've adopted project management within their organization. They're using it to develop business processes, using it to train project managers, and they're using it to create career paths for you as individuals as project managers. Adding a large corporation, a large size, just adds more to the complexity of implementing the change. So it's not about size, it's about how you're using project management to help do these transformations. Let's go back a little bit more and talk about organizations and how they've evolved, certainly in the last 50 years or so. We all know organizations have grown immensely. They've become very large and become very global. You know, the technology that we've come up with has certainly helped and allowed this to happen, but they've also developed social structures that have helped as well. An organizational structure that allows these organizations to become as large as they have. Initially, the main structure was adopted by business was the one of functional. We're quite familiar with this. We have departments that are specializing in certain areas, whether it be marketing or finance. This was adopted by business, and governments picked up on this, as well as many not-for-profit organizations as well. But this type of organization is not without some of its challenges. You know, as in the 60s, in the 1960s, we started to see these organizations become global, and observers were truly impressed with the size and how well they were able to do. But they also noticed that the organization that was structured for doing routine day-to-day operations did it very efficiently, started to challenge as they became to look at initiatives that started across departmental lines, things that were done uniquely, things that had specific timelines that needed to be done, what we call projects. When I first started working back in, I won't say about how long ago, my kids keep reminding me of that. When I first started working, I worked for a large functional organization, telecommunications business in Canada. And when we did small projects within our department, things went fine. But as soon as these projects started to get large and cross multiple departments, or get complex and cross multiple departments, things started to fall apart. And very quickly, we were running behind schedule. We had to escalate up to senior management to get the appropriate support. In the 1960s, some of the observers of project management, people like Peter Drucker, Alan Toffler, and Warren Beenis, identified this as a challenge and started to think about ways that they could actually restructure these functional organizations to help them become more efficient at doing projects. One of the techniques they implemented was something called a matrix organization. I've had the pleasure of working in a matrix organization. Initially, I thought this would be great. I would have, in a matrix organization, you have a functional manager and a project manager. So I could tell my functional manager I was working on the project, and tell my project manager I was working in a functional area, and take the day off. It didn't happen that way, right? My project manager said I had all these things to do. My functional manager gave me another list to do, and I ended up working twice as hard and twice as long. It was also around this time, though, in the 60s, we started to see the words project management appear in the lexicon of industry. Now, certainly project management is not new. There's been a number of organizations, a number of kinds of activities that organizations have done, or certain types of organizations that were always based on this idea of doing a project, something that's unique, that has a beginning and an end. Often they were in the infrastructure area, looking at doing new buildings, looking at putting in roads, airports, other transportation systems, improving roads and other infrastructure. These types of projects, people understood, you had to bring together resources with different skills in order to get them done. They also recognized they needed a more flexible form of organization that could bring the resources together, that the resources understood when they needed to be on the job, how long they had to do the specific tasks. They also, so that you minimize the amount of time that they had to wait for other workers to finish their tasks. At first, these were somewhat intuitive and informal. It was, when you're building a house, it's not too difficult to know you have to do the foundation first before you do the walls, and the walls before you do your roof. But as things got a little bit complex and a little bit more sophisticated, so these organizations started to develop specialized tools and techniques. Things like the Gantt chart, the critical path method was developed out of DuPont with the chemical engineers looking at how to build very complex production lines for chemicals. As things evolved, and especially with the advent of World War II, and after that with the Cold War and the race to the moon, we saw that we've got increasingly more complex projects and more business and areas of research, things like operations research that were applied widely during World War II, systems engineering, systems management that also developed in this, especially in the defense industries, as I said, in NASA's A Race to the Moon, and they started developing new techniques and new ideas for how to manage projects. We started to see at this time things like the Program Execution and Review Technique, PERT, Network Analysis, as well as Earned Value Management coming out. It's very interesting, last month at the North American Global Congress, being the 40th anniversary of PMI, three of the founders were at the Congress, and they talked to us about the history of PMI. And PMI founded 40 years ago. And at this time, when PMI was first founded, so in the late 1969, so during the 60s, there was a lot of discussion of how to build schedules and how to build schedules that could minimize the downtime for resources or maximize the utilization of resources. And that was sort of the early genesis of project management, was focusing on schedules. Also in the 60s and on to the 70s, we started to get the advent of computers. And what they allowed us to do is to start developing computer applications that could manage schedules more effectively to help us calculate critical paths for some of these very complex network diagrams that we come up with for these large complex projects. And we got seeing a very powerful feedback loop where project managers started using computer tools to help manage these large projects, and some of the larger and more complex projects were actually to develop computer software, computer hardware, and networks. So project management was used to develop more powerful computers, which gave us better tools to use in project management. As project management's evolved, we've seen it grow from some of these very technical skills used for scheduling and for control into some of these more general business skills, things such as identifying requirements, clarifying what the objectives are, managing the triple constraint of time, cost, and scope, managing stakeholders. These are often viewed as general business management skills, but they are being applied to a very specific project with its very unique deliverable, and the idea of having a beginning and an end made them viewed as very unique skills for project management. So through both the development of sophisticated technical skills for building schedules and doing cost estimating, as well as the advent of soft skills that we have now come to see being required by machinery, it does not include the billions of dollars that are spent on private investment for things like business process improvement, software products, projects that are being implemented, development of pharmaceuticals, and as well as a lot of IP, intellectual property, radio, television, and so on. So there's a huge investment in being made in the world economy today. We've already seen a number of examples here of what's being done in India, and certainly coming from Canada and North America, that with the recession having an impact on our economy, that the government is putting even more money into infrastructure. So there's a large market out there of work being done by project managers. In fact, in a research study done in 2007 by PMI, it estimates that 20 million people worldwide are working some way or other on projects. So even though we are in a recession, with very high growth rates in East Asia and in South Asia, by comparison to the G8 countries, is still continuing. I know India slipped from double-digit growth down to 7 or 8%, which is certainly still significantly higher. So you've still got a huge number of projects that you're being attempted here in India to be done. And as well, we've got a multinational global economy that we're starting to work in, which is also showing a lot of growth. Before I started my job at Ryerson University, I worked for a small international IT software company where we set up an office in that little city just south of here called Bangalore, which I've had the pleasure to visit twice. So this is my third trip to India. And having to develop an outsourcing site in Bangalore where we wanted to move some of our work over to Bangalore to be done some of the software development work, it required project management. It required us as an organization to have a certain amount of project management maturity and use a common process throughout the organization so that we could ensure that we could manage the project effectively and be on time and be on budget. A driver for many organizations to look at multinational teams for building projects is not only based on the cost drivers, but also the need to be much more flexible in serving customers at certain times and to meet the competitive pressures that's being brought to bear on all organizations. Another demand for project management that we're seeing is what we'll call a war on talent. Is that post-World War II, we had a baby boom, first in Japan and Western Europe, then in the other G8 countries, and even now here in India, that is starting to work through their working life. That we're starting to see now that the baby boomers are starting to retire and pass through the workforce. Well, the baby boomers didn't generate as many people to replace them in the workplace. So there's less workers out there, less potential project managers to replace the baby boomers as they go through. This is forcing organizations to become a lot more effective in terms of how they manage projects. In particular, they're looking at ways to attract the best project managers, to grow project managers through investment in training and developing processes so that the project managers can step in and be productive as the experienced resources that are retiring, and also give ways to retain these individuals once they have them, because there's going to be other organizations looking to attract them to their organization. And the final thing that we see happening is the whole area of corporate social responsibility, CSR, and sustainability. This initiative that's coming, certainly from a governance point of view, started with the Sarbanes-Oxley laws in the United States and has spread throughout the world to start having organizations to be more transparent. So what we're seeing here is that organizations are having to have business processes that will allow their senior management and boards to make sure that they are following policies that are set uniformly throughout the company. So once again, these are opportunities for project managers to manage projects doing business process reengineering. In addition, project management applied uniformly and at a good level of maturity in an organization is a way to show compliance to these policies, in that project management, through the controls that are in place, through the planning that's done to prepare budgets and schedules, and then monitoring those budgets and schedules, noting when there's changes and documenting those changes and getting appropriate approval, are exactly some of the governance structures that organizations are looking for. And finally, just like to mention a little bit about sustainability and looking at from a perspective of the triple bottom line of both environmental, social, and economic. This too will create more demands for projects as organizations are looking to become more sustainable. This is a type of project, but from a project management point of view, I think it will bring on two things, or three things I should say. First is that you as a project manager will start having to look at the sustainability nature of your project. You're going to start getting have a lot broader breadth around your project. Is it meeting the strategic objectives of your organization? How is the supply chain working for the product or service that you're going to produce? Is it sustainable? Is the product as a whole, from a life cycle point of view, is it also sustainable? These are questions that we're not asking as project managers, but I think in the future we will have to ask. You will also be looking at your project as, are you managing it in a sustainable way? Are you using your resources effectively? Not just the people resources, but the whole, all the other resources that you're deploying for your project. And the third thing which myself and my colleagues on the board are thinking about is the profession of project management a sustainable one? But we'll leave that for discussion later on in the conference. So we can see there's quite a demand for project managers out there. And one of the things that I think best shows this is a study that PMI commissioned in 2008. They asked the Economist Information Unit to interview some senior executives. And they interviewed almost 600 senior executives from global, national, global, and multinational organizations. And they asked them two things. One was, what skill was most important for their staff to have? And they came back and said, the ability to execute. To execute projects. The second question they asked was, what was the capability their organization most needed? And the response was the ability to implement strategic change, to do change, to transform the organization. Well, how do you change an organization? How do you transform the organization? How do you introduce new products? How do you introduce new processes within the organization? How do you do research and development? How do you innovate? It's all done through projects. So effectively what the senior executives were saying was, two sides of the same coin, that project management is a strategic competency that their organizations need in order to be successful. You know that here. Many of the organizations know that here we've talked about. Infosys, as an example, knows it, and this is why PMI chose to highlight it in last year's annual report, reflecting of how they see project management as a strategic competency. But they're not the only one, and certainly the comments that were made earlier have shown that you here recognize that project management is very important for the future of India. You have thousands, hundreds of thousands of projects ranging from the classic infrastructure projects of water, power, transportation, to the very complex IT projects that are being done here. Certainly I'm very proud that PMI has recognized this and has committed to the advancement of project management in India. As you know, we've opened up two regional offices here, Raj being the managing director of the operation in India, as a recognition of the importance of project management in the Indian market. And you too have recognized it. 20 years ago, there were barely 20 members of PMI in India. Now you can see from the graph, there's over 12,000 members. There are 7 chapters now spread across India as well, showing how well we have grown. And in fact, the over 12,000 members in India is the third largest membership of any country in around the world and the largest outside of North America. Canada's the second largest. We can all guess who the first is. I'm sure some of you were here last year when Greg Ballesteros and the chair of the PMI board last year, Philip Diab, presented an award to Dr. Sridharan to recognize his outstanding career and as a whole, and in particular his leadership on the Delhi Metro Rail project. Now, I know you know more about the Delhi Metro Road project, and I'm sure some of you are from Delhi and use it every day than I do, but it's certainly a very impressive project to talk about. Well, phase one consisted of 68 kilometers of track, 62 stations. The system is now carrying over 700,000 passengers a day. It has served as a model for many metro projects, subway metro projects from around the world, having visitors from business all over the world, including from Harvard. The team has been asked to prepare detailed reports how they did the project management on the project. It came in on time, on budget, which is a rarity for many of these large infrastructure projects, especially when you're dealing with a public-private partnership. And these reports have been for consultations from countries from around the world, including Pakistan, Bangladesh, Indonesia, Sri Lanka, Syria, Iran, and Indonesia. And hopefully sometime my colleagues from the city of Toronto will come here so we can get a better transportation system in Toronto. As Dr. Sridharan commented, the Delhi Metro is a stunning example of how government project can be done properly. You know, it's not only the fact that he led a project team that was able to get the project done on time and on budget that's that's very impressive, but the fact he was able to do that has given confidence in the Indian government to invest in more infrastructure projects and to use more project management. I mean, India is now planning a number of more metro systems, the Kyoto extension in Mumbai and Bangalore and right here in Hyderabad. Anticipating the 2014 Commonwealth Games, which are being held next year in Delhi, you know, wanting to expand their small metro system, the city of Glasgow has come to study how the Delhi Metro Rail system was able to implement their expansion so quickly and in such a fine way in terms of getting it done on time and on budget. Phase two is well underway and current tracking to be on time, if not a little bit earlier, which leaves good confidence that by 2021 there'll be 241 kilometers of rail system for the citizens of Delhi to use. Delhi Metro Rail is not the only one. VSR mentioned about Nano. Just 2 weeks ago, PMI took part in the Economist Innovation Awards in London, England. Mark Langley, the Senior Vice President of PMI and the Chief Operating Officer, presented an award for innovation and business process to the Vice Chairman of Tata Motors, Mr. Vavi Kent. Now, as you know, the thing that sort of caught all our attention around the Nano was the price. It's a very inexpensive car. But it wasn't that Mark Langley seized upon when he made his comments for the award. He focused on the fact that Tata brought in Delphi and Bosch and other suppliers much earlier in the design stage than is usual in the industry. They got their partners to be involved to help them design the car to be at that low price point. In addition, Tata came up with a distribution strategy which would distribute the car as kits for assembly to be done locally. These innovations go to the definition of what automakers do. It was moving the boundary between our customers, our business rather, and our partners, more than it's moved in 100 years. And that was what was so innovative about the car, was about the revolution in new business model. In looking through the agenda of some of the presenters that you have tomorrow and Sunday, I think there's more examples of some of these revolutionary new business models that's coming out of the coming out of India here that is going to be transforming the way you do business and, in fact, the way we do business globally. But if project management can be a catalyst for transforming India, and you take pride in the work that's been in, by Dr. Shrihan's accomplishments, those by Tata, the other organizations we've heard about here already today, and those that you'll hear more about tomorrow and Sunday, this is just the beginning. I challenge everyone here to take what you've learned, what you apply today in your work, and start spreading the word through your colleagues, through your organization, through your friends, and through other organizations of what project management can do to help transforming India and the global economy. We at PMI are here to help, and we've already got a number of tools that you can use to help you. First is starting with the PMI standards. We have 12 standards right now, ranging from program management, the PMBOK guide, to, as was mentioned earlier, the program and portfolio standards, as well as a number of others. These standards are developed by practitioners, those people like yourselves who are project managers, and they volunteer their time to share their experience of how projects are done and what the best ways to do projects are. I certainly encourage each of you, as you get familiar with project management and you have things to share, to get involved in the development of these standards. The standards are renewed regularly every 4 years, and in fact, so there's lots of opportunities to get involved and to learn more about the standards and actually shape the future of project management. And in fact, the PMBOK guide has over 3 million copies in circulation right now. Besides the PMI credentials, besides the PMI standards, we also have the PMI credentials. For those who are starting off the career, we have the CAPM, Certified Associate in Project Management. Last year, we introduced the Scheduling Professional and the Risk Management Professional. Those are for individuals who want to specialize in those very specific areas of project management. People get further along in their careers and start managing projects or getting to the point where they can manage projects, we have the PMP, the Project Management Professional. This is, of course, by far the most widely recognized credential, and it is recognized globally, as all PMI credentials are. With, as Steve reminded me earlier today, 360,000 credential holders worldwide, which is truly very impressive. And then finally, we have the PGPMP credential for program management. So for those individuals who are starting to manage multiple projects that are working together to deliver a business objective. So India, as I mentioned earlier about the growth here of the membership, is just part of a larger picture of growth of PMI worldwide. We now have over 300,000 members of PMI. As you can see, just a few years ago, we were at 33,000. The growth here in the Asia-Pacific region has gone from 0.25% of the membership in 1967 to 14% of the membership in 2009. So as the organization is growing, it's growing much more rapidly here in the Asia-Pacific region and specifically in the subcontinent. So just to summarize my comments, so what we've seen is that project management has a unique set of competencies, both on the technical and the non-technical area. And these competencies are being recognized by organizations here in India and around the world as being required for them to meet their strategic objectives. They're using them because they will deliver projects in more reliably, they will deliver them on time with better performance, they'll allow these organizations to implement strategic change, they'll allow the organizations to work on multi-location, multinational project teams. They give a consistency and maturity that will allow organizations to bid on projects and work in other countries. And that they can take part of these trillions of dollars that are out there that are being invested in infrastructure. And having a mature project management system will allow projects to transfer from being the project and getting the product or service completed into an operational phase. In addition, they're recognizing that project management is a profession that can provide a very rewarding and exciting career, certainly a challenging one, and I have found that to be the case. So that companies can investing in that will be able to attract and retain the best people for them to continue to grow as an organization. So, thank you very much.